95 tonight, and I get right down to the end of the exit, and I'm just about to come on to 95, and I stop my car. Okay, like I can't merge. I get very mad at myself. I get upset. I start yelling and screaming. So I'm on the ramp, and I'm just about to come on to 95, stop the car. I get out, yelling and screaming at myself because I cannot do it. And all of a sudden, I get some noise behind me. I turn around, I look, and there's a whole line of cars. And all the drivers of those cars are out yelling and screaming, too. So it was then that I realized that I was the only one that had this problem. So anyway, so I get on to 95, and now I have to get on to 133 to get here. Anybody ever hit an animal?
Yeah.
Yeah? What?
Dog.
Dog, oh. Dog, yeah. I remember that. Dog. Dog. Okay. Usually if you hit a dog or something bigger, people stop, right? Well, I hit a cat. I have never in my life hit a cat before. So, usually I see other people get past and they just keep going. Well, I was gonna keep going. But there's this little girl standing on the side of the road. So I decided to stop in front of her cat, right? So I pull the car over and I said to the little girl, I'm real sorry that I killed your cat. She says, well, it's not my cat. I said, well, do you know what it belongs to? And she says, yeah, the lady that lives in that house up there. I said, well, all right, I better go tell her. So I go up to the house, I knock on the door. The lady comes to the door, she says, can I help you? I said, yeah, I think I just killed your cat. She says, well, how do you know it's my cat? And I said, well, that little girl down there told me that it belonged to the lady in this house. And the lady says to me, well, what does the cat look like? I said, now? Now you want to know what the cat looks like? She says, no. She says, what did it look like just before you hit it? So I went. She wasn't too amused. I have bad luck with animals. I have a German Shepherd. My neighbors have a rabbit. Exactly. So the other day, yesterday, as a matter of fact, I'm standing in my kitchen window doing the dishes. Finish the last dish, I look out the window, and it's my German Shepherd. He's got the next door neighbor's rabbit in his mouth. I'm panicked, I don't know what to do. So I go outside, take the rabbit out of the German Shepherd's mouth. It's all dirty, and it's dead. And I'm like, oh, now what the hell am I going to do? So I come in the house, and I'm standing there thinking, okay, what can I do, what can I do? My first instinct was to go over to the phone and call my neighbor, tell her what happened. So I go over to the phone, I start the dial. Then my second instinct takes over. So I turn around, I go over to the kitchen sink, and I put the rabbit in the sink, and I wash it. Then I take out my blow dryer, and I blow dry it. And I look out the window, make sure nobody's looking. And I went over to my neighbor's yard, and I put the rabbit back in the cage. And I figured, not my problem anymore. This morning, there's a knock on my door. My neighbor. She comes in and she says, Ronnie, you're never going to believe what happened. Huh. And I'm thinking to myself, right now, please just fuck anything. She says to me, 2 days ago, my rabbit died, and I buried it out the backyard. No luck. No luck with animals whatsoever. Okay, you people tonight here are here to see a burlesque show. And I'm going to explain to you a little bit about burlesque. Burlesque is like vaudeville. Remember the old vaudeville show? Not too dirty, right? Some of you remember? Yeah, you don't remember. Neither do I. But burlesque is like vaudeville, but burlesque gets a little dirty. But you people already knew that, or else you wouldn't be here, right? Okay, does anybody have one of those? I'm going to give a little demonstration. Anyone have those cocktail napkins? Anybody? Under the glass?
I brought them with me.
Oh,
my
thank God. Okay, I'm going to make a little prop here. You guys can just go out and talk amongst yourselves. Okay, this is a bowl. All right? I guess the difference between vaudeville and burlesque. This is vaudeville. This is vaudeville for us. You must pay the rent.
But I can't pay the rent.
You must pay the rent.
But I can't pay the rent.
I'll pay the rent.
My hero.
Curses. Boiled again. That's vaudeville. Now, burlesque is kind of the same thing, but it's a little twist. It's going to go something like this. You must pay the rent.
But I can't pay the rent.
You must pay the rent.
But I can't pay the rent.
If you don't pay the rent, it's the woods.
Oh, no, not the woods. My mother wouldn't like it.
Your mother loved it.
The woods, the woods, the woods.
Okay. To get on to that show, I'm going to
why. We weren't even sure about the guy that played the organ. We wouldn't play anything but him.
Who do you think was your best performance?
Probably the night I took 3 blondes to Atlantic City.
No, I mean your best singing performance.
Oh, I used to sing in the opera.
Oh, yeah?
Toriadora, don't spit on the floor. Use the cuspidora, that's the what it's for.
Oh, well, anyway, let's introduce everybody. Paul, you know Ron, you know Paul.
Safe in there.
Bell, did you see that? She said I could beat her up.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you will now be entertained by Mr. Shedhouse himself. I want girl dies like you're gonna marry dear old dad. She was pearl and the only old daddy ever had. A real old-fashioned girl with heart so true. One who loved nobody else but you. I want a girl just...
See that? She dropped a purse. And I, being a proper Southern fried chicken, will return it to her.
Never know how much I love you. Never know how much I care. When you talk around me, I get a fever that's so hard to say. You give me fever. When you kiss me, fever. When you hold me tight, fever. In the morning, a fever all through the night. Sun lights up the daytime, moon lights up the night. I light up when you call my name, and you know I'm gonna be right. You give me fever when you kiss me, fever when you hold me tight. Fever in the morning, fever all through the night. Everybody got the fever, that is something you all know. Fever is such a new thing, fever started long ago. Romeo loved Juliet, Juliet he found the same. When he put his arms around it, when you
Four old ladies walking down. here.
Wait a minute. You ran an old lady up an alley?
Well, no, well, actually, she coaxed me up here. Give me a break, will you? I was up the alley by myself.
What were you doing?
I was taking a shortcut. All right, now, poor old lady's walking down the street, and she's got a basket on her arm.
Which arm?
Her left arm. It was the only damn one she had left. Hey, want to hear a funny noise?
Sure.
Stick your head in there.
Thank you.
about a horse?
Did he say something about a horse?
No.
Nothing about a horse, huh?
Hiya,
please. Guilty.
Oh, thank you.
something wrong?
Of course she did. You didn't use any tact.
What you should have said was, excuse me, sir. And that way she would have known that you had noticed her, and she wouldn't have been so in damn ass.
Miami.
Could I call a hero?
Hero? You call a hero?
once was a farmer who lived by a rock. He sat in the meadow a-shaking his fist at some boys who were down by the creek, their feet in the water, their hands on their marbles and playthings. And in days of yore, there came a young lady. She looked like a pretty young creature. She sat on the grass, she pulled up her dresses and showed us her
I know. How about if we play husband and wife?
joke. God will get you to that.
Father Mark is going to take us on the next step of our religious journey.
There was a young man who had just gotten a job driving a limousine, and his very first assignment was to pick up His Holiness the Pope, who was in the country to deliver a lecture at a seminary. So the young man got to the airport, picked the Pope up right on time, got him bundled into the limousine, no problem, and they're on the freeway driving to the seminary where the Pope is delivering the lecture. And suddenly the phone rings in the car, and the Pope picks up the phone, and it's one of the cardinals from the Vatican. It's urgent business. The Pope has to get back to Rome right away. So the Pope buzzes up to the front of the car and says, my son, I need you to turn the car around right away. I have to get back to Rome. So as soon as he can, the limo driver pulls off the freeway, turns around, gets back on the freeway, and starts heading back to the airport. And he's driving the speed limit. You know, he doesn't want to get in any trouble, especially with the Pope in the back seat of the car. It probably wouldn't look too good. So he's doing the speed limit, and the Pope's getting frustrated. And after a couple of minutes, the Pope buzzes up in front of the car again and says, my son, I need you to drive a little faster than this. This is urgent business. It's the Lord's work. I have to go. So the young man picks up the speed a little bit more. He's driving about 60 now, still not wanting to get in any kind of trouble. And the Pope gets more and more frustrated. He buzzes up front again. He says, my son, I think the Lord will forgive you for breaking this one rule just this one time. Could you please step it up a little? So the limo driver picks it up to about 65, still not wanting to get in any trouble. And the Pope gets more and more frustrated. He buzzes up front again. He says, my son, pull over. The limo driver pulls to the side of the freeway. And the Pope jumps out of the car right there on the freeway, marches up to the front of the limousine, yanks the door open, and says, my son, get out. The limo driver steps out of the car. The Pope jumps in, slams the door. And before he can take off, the limo driver runs to the back of the car, jumps in, slams the door. Jumps in and slams the door. We're on a slight tank delay here, folks. And he's gone. The Pope is gone. He's driving. He's gone like a bat out of, well, you know. And almost immediately gets pulled over by the state police. The trooper gets him, pulls him to the side of the road. And the trooper gets out of the car, adjusts that, you know, silly hat they all wear. And he goes up to the limousine. He tries to look in the back. He can't see a thing because of the smoke glass. So he goes up to the front. And he knocks on the driver's window. The window comes down. And the state trooper is looking at the smiling face of His Holiness the Pope. And the trooper's a little perplexed by this. And he says, I'll be right back. Excuse me, just a minute. And he runs back to the squad car, gets on the radio, and says, Lieutenant, you're not going to believe this. You told me to let you know if I ever pulled a dignitary to the side of the road. And boy, have I got one now. And the lieutenant says, what, who you got, a congressman? And the trooper says, no, bigger than that. The lieutenant says, senator? The trooper says, no, bigger than that. And the lieutenant says, you got the president of the United States pulled to the side of the road? And the trooper says, no, this is bigger than that. And the lieutenant says, bigger than, who could possibly be bigger than the president of the United States? And the trooper says, I'm not entirely sure, but the Pope's driving his car. Bow your head in great respect and gentle attention.
guy comes running down the hall. He goes into a room and he says, guess how old I am today? I hear the tape in the room go, I don't know. He says, I'm 80 years old today. And I came running down to another room and he goes in. He says, guess how old I am today? I'm 80 years old today. And he goes right down to another room and he goes in. He says, guess how old I am today? There's this real, real old woman laying on the bed. And he says, come up to my bed. Come closer. I can't see you. And he goes right up to the bed. He says, guess how old I am today? He says, pull your pants down. So he drops his pants to the floor and she goes,
ha ha.